wants to be home and doing other things, but this is a good thing. Many of you know me. My name is James Van Beek. I've been an Eagle County resident for 25 years. I've been a born and raised native state in Colorado. Born of immigrant parents who came over to the United States and came to Colorado in 1957. We started coming up as a family in 1971 to this area. We fell in love with the area. In 1983, my parents moved to this area, and several years later, I followed them and I started at the Eagle County Sheriff's Office. My experience with the Eagle County Sheriff's Office was about 12 years of full-time and about 3 years of 3 to 4 years of part-time. I also had 8 years of international police experience. During my time here at Eagle County, I was working as a patrol officer, as a field training officer. I was as an investigator. I've been involved with the World Cup. I've been involved with the World Forum and with 99s. I wanted to be your sheriff because I was encouraged, starting back in 2002 and then 2010, the first time that I ran, because I wanted to see the sheriff's office become more professional, more transparent, and more progressive and open with the communities. At the time that I announced my intent to seek office, I was still serving in Afghanistan, but I came back, I had 6 weeks, and I ran, and I got within 82 votes. I continued to listen to the people, and the people talked to me again. And so, again, this year, in 2014, perception of the sheriff's office has changed very little. Someone once observed that in a democratic society, that the police are only as effective as the people allow them to be. I want to work with the people, I want to be transparent with the people, and I want to bring Eagle County back. I want to have a cooperative, and I want it to be the cohesiveness that binds our county together and all our law enforcement and EMS services. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Daric, your opening remarks.
Good evening. My name is Daric Harvey. I would like to thank those who organized this event and made it possible for our community to be able to hear the candidates on issues that are important to all of us. Most importantly, I would like to thank each one of you for taking the time to learn more about who should lead and be our next Eagle County Sheriff. The Sheriff is a representative for the people, a partner in the safety and security of our county. Partnerships are built on trust and respect, and those are cornerstones for any police leader, modern and progressive. My family and I first came to the Valley about 7 years ago for a skiing vacation and really loved the place, wanted to move here. My daughter, my teenage sons, my wife and I, we wanted to move and make it a permanent move. I was fortunate enough to be hired as the police commander in Vail, and we bought a house in Gypsum and made it our home. I was one of 90 candidates nationwide who applied for that one position, and the reason why I was chosen to fulfill that important role is based on my law enforcement experience providing law enforcement services to communities whose economic base is driven by tourism, all last almost 19 years. After arriving in Eagle County, I immediately became involved in helping our community and was asked to join two nonprofit boards in the Valley, the Bright Future Foundation and the Total Health Alliance. As a police commander, I started the Police Explorer Program, a nationally recognized program that helps build and strengthen relationships between the police and our youth. I want to build stronger relationships with our Latino community. I have great ideas for leadership and training within our organization. But mostly, I want to be the leader who puts service above self and helps the sheriff's office realize its potential. Thank you.
Thank you. My first question during the break, I was encouraged to try to work in some more audience questions, so I'll direct this to you, James. In light of the Ferguson incident, what is your stance on the militarization of local police?
I have a lot of concern about the perception of the militarization of the police. I had a lot of concerns that I sat from my perspective looking at Ferguson, because I come from a community policing background, a community-involved background from the policing, and as a crisis and a hostage negotiator. So I was always a softer approach before I got to the much harder approach. I've experienced the militarization, even when I was overseas and so on, where I was working as a civilian police officer And we were trying to teach democratic policing to the people in Kosovo or the people in Afghanistan. And we had to get the military to understand that they're, while often we're going down parallel paths, their approach is different. I have a lot of concerns about a heavy-handed approach. My approach would be first to build trust in the community, to problem solve in the community, to deal with the issues before they ferment and that they become a large issue. Broken window theory. Let's look for the cause. Let's look for prevention before we get to this point. At the same time, there are times when the police have to get a little heavier handed and that they need to enforce the law. And that is a good thing, but that would be a final result, not the very first result. Perception of military vehicles coming in and being given to law enforcement. It also concerns me because of the ties with the federal and what the strings are that are attached. It concerns me with what are the costs of the upkeep? Is it practical? Is it actually worthwhile? There's times that it could very well be worthwhile, but can we sit there and multitask it, multi-use it throughout the entire western slope as opposed to just keeping it in park and having it rot except for one occasion? Thank you very much.
Daric, your thoughts?
Thank you very much. I think what we see in Ferguson is a symptom of a greater problem, and that's really a separation between the community and the police. There are times and tactics when bulletproof vehicles are appropriate. If someone was attacking our schools and we had active shooters that were actually on our school grounds, I would want an armored vehicle to be able to run up and save our children. There are times when those things are appropriate, but it is the application in that, how those are used, and that comes from the leadership. And the leadership has to have a good relationship with the community, and that's really what's symptomatic. I've seen that in Florida. You've seen it in other places. Seattle, for example. Everyone can remember the World Trade Organization riots. It was handled very poorly, very strong-handed. The chief that came in after had a very different approach when that came back. And it was engaging those leaders to see and hear what their concerns were, provide them with opportunities to be able to have their concerns heard, not only in a public forum, but also by the leadership that was there. Concessions have to be made. I've policed in Daytona Beach where there were 150,000 people in a very small area. I've policed in Vail where we've had 10, 15,000 people in a very small area. Crowds can happen at any location, but going back to the relationship piece is if somebody perceives that the police are doing something wrong, the sheriff, the police chief, needs to have people in the community he can go to and say, here's what's going on and here's what we're going to do about it. What are your concerns and how can we work together? That's the true underlying theory behind community-oriented policing. It's working with the community, which is why I said the sheriff is a representative for the people. He's a partner in the safety and security. We can't do it alone. It takes the community. And those bonds happen long before angry people take to the streets and start tearing things up. Thank you.
Second question goes to you first, Daric. I've had the privilege of living in Eagle County for 2 decades now. I have yet to see at any law enforcement level women in a position of leadership. I wonder what you might do to change that if elected.
You know, I've actually reached out to several people. Sheriff Rebecca Spees, for example, in Mesa County. Very strong woman, very capable woman, who took over after Sheriff Stan Hilke was offered a position down in Denver. What I really foresee is not only just women, but also Latinos in our community that need representation. And a sheriff's office or a police department should be representative of whatever community it is serving. Obviously, recruiting has something to do with that. Talking with folks in the community to recruit in certain areas where minorities and women are specifically in, looking for jobs, and making it a conducive environment that is a professional environment that everyone can come to work, feel good about what they're doing. I think that's really what we all want, regardless of who you are, what color you are, what sex or gender you are, or what your affiliation is. That's the basis of what democracy is all about, is that making everyone want to be able to come to work and have a good time. And by have a good time, I mean job satisfaction and fulfillment, equal pay, equal position, equal opportunity to be able to promote. And I think that doesn't just start with male or female. I think that starts with succession planning, which comes from me as the sheriff. That succession planning is setting our folks up, regardless of who they are, to be able to promote within the organization. And you know what happens when we do that? When we have somebody within inside the organization that says, hey, this is a great place to work. I'm Latino. I'm female. You should come work here too. That's the best recruiting strategy that we can have as our own people.
James, question to you.
Repeat it for me, Mr.
Mayor. Yeah, the question was just my own observation that in my two decades here, I have yet to see a woman in a position of leadership at any level of law enforcement within the county. I wonder what you would do if elected to change that.
You know, I think first and foremost, it just goes on the attitude of the in the presentation of the sheriff's office and the sheriff and the chief. There were some females from times back that were in command positions and lower command positions, Kim Andre for one. But I agree with you that there are a lot of, and there's a lot of need. I think first and foremost, it goes back to developing a relationship with the community and a developing a relationship with the staff. To have a very clear and delineated code of ethics and a very clear and delineated philosophy and proactive program to encourage them to promote within and to make it a place where people want to be and make it a place where people are proud to be. And I think by doing so, I mean, everyone would have the equal opportunity, whether, you know, it would be a female, whether it would be a minority, to encourage them to come, to feel like they belong, to feel like they have a say-so, and that they're empowered to make a difference, and by doing so that they would want to stay long-term, to continue to develop, and to continue to reach out to the community, and to be empowered to be in charge. So I think if you follow that path and follow the true philosophy and follow a true code of ethics, that it's unbiased and that it's encouraged by anybody who wants to step forward and take the chance, I think that would be the way to go forward with it.
Daric, my question is directed to you. There are statutes that seem to be difficult to enforce. A recent one that comes to mind that was recently enacted is the 15-round magazine limit in terms of being illegal to own that. First of all, your thoughts on how you would go about enforcing that statute or if it's enforceable. And second, what other statutes come to mind as sheriff that might be difficult for you to enforce here in Eagle County?
Well, I think the first response to you is really as sheriff, difficult or not, my sworn duty is to uphold the laws of the state of Colorado and the Constitution of the United States. So what you're referring to there is the actual conflict between when a state law counteracts a federal law, or what we believe to be a violation of the Constitution. Statute 1812, I believe it's 302, and 1812 are the two that you're referring to there. So both of those statutes were recently reviewed in June by Judge Krieger, who is the U.S. District Court judge for this area. And she ruled on both of those that essentially you had to have standing for both of those to be reviewed as a violation of the Constitution, essentially. So what I mean by standing is you have to actually have something taken away from you. That's where the real difficulty lies, because as sheriff, if I believe something violates the Constitution, I don't want someone to have to get arrested in order for us to go to the judge and say, we believe this law violates the Constitution. The appropriate course of action there is really preemptively talking to legislature, working through the county sheriffs of Colorado, working with our local representatives and state senators to say, those are going to be some problems for us, and here's what those problems are. So before somebody has to get injured in the court review, essentially, to be able to say, this is a violation of the Constitution, whether it's marijuana, we need to be proactive on it. Whether it's gun control, we need to be proactive on it. We need to see these things coming down. And my job as sheriff is to see those things coming and say, hey, guys, this is what's happening. Guys, gals, everyone, this is what's important. This is what's going to happen. So state representatives, we need your help on this. Help us be able to enforce the law fairly and equitably across Colorado.
Thank you. James?
It's So specifically, you were talking about the 15-round magazine, or were you talking about the both House bills that were passed?
Both. Well, first of all, do you see that as sheriff, how would you see yourself enforcing that law, or is it enforceable? And second of all, is there another law that's more important to talk about in terms of challenges of enforcement as sheriff here in Eagle County?
Well, I'll deal with the second part first. Okay. Majority of the laws are very difficult. I mean, and it's going to be on some are very carte blanche, some are more obtuse and obscure. There is the grandfather clause in the House bills, and so it is very, very difficult to enforce when it comes to the magazines. It's even says a person may possess a large capacity magazine or if he or she owns the magazine on July 1st, 2013, and maintains continuous possession of that magazine. So again, how am I going to be able to do this? So no, it is not practical to try to enforce that law. I believe it is part of the sheriff's role is to challenge the state legislature and make it very clear to them that if they are going to put something and put a burden upon the law enforcement in the state of Colorado or the law enforcement anywhere, that first of all, we have to know that it's constitutionally correct. And second of all, that it's enforceable. I mean, you can write a law and says that you can't do certain things, but if there's no way enforceable, then there's no purpose in it, and it's a waste of our time. It's a waste of the taxpayers' resources. It's a waste of effort. And I believe that going in to do that is a multifaceted approach. It is through the County Sheriff's Colorado. It is through the Chiefs of Police Association. It is through gun rights advocate groups. It is through education to the legislatures to let them understand that by what they're doing, they are compromising the constitutional rights of the people, and as well as they're making a law that's unenforceable. And so by doing so, I think Mr. Harvey even sat there and said, even for the marijuana laws, if they're jumping across and they're jumping the gun because they say, now we do have the marijuana laws, can we enforce these laws? Is it practical? Because public safety comes first. How are we going to deal with it on a public safety matter? It's going to be entirely too difficult for me to sit there and walk up to you, Greg, and sit there and say, Greg, did you own this? Or I have to prove otherwise. So it's not a practical enforcement. It's a waste of our effort.
Thank you.
James, last question goes to you first. What do you believe is the greatest law enforcement challenge facing youth in Eagle County, and what would you do proactively to address that?
The last part I couldn't hear.
I said, the question again. What do you believe the number one challenge facing youth in Eagle County is regarding law enforcement, and what would you do to proactively address it?
For the youth themselves, goes back to my philosophy of community policing and being out in the community. The youth in Eagle County, the youth anywhere have a totally different perception of as an adult. It's part of the maturing process. Some people would sit there and say that the drinking in Eagle County is kind of a passing of the tradition and that they're moving forward again. Some of the drugs that get done here in Eagle County. But I think for the youth, it's also a matter of the trust and the understanding of as they approach their 18th birthday, as they understand the dynamics of becoming an adult, the dynamics of becoming a voting citizen, the dynamics of becoming 18, and now they are an adult, and how their actions now affect them. I think by doing that is, again, by engaging them in different systems, by community policing, being out in the community, working with them, being in the schools, the school resource officers, interacting, engaging, building the level of trust, building the level of understanding, Explorer programs, Boy Scout programs, auxiliary programs within the Eagle County Sheriff's Office, assistance programs that I'd like to see them do, to bring them along and to develop them to becoming long-term citizens and to be proactive, not just in law enforcement, but we're talking into the fire services, we're talking about into the EMS, and also just a greater understanding and level of trust, keeping them away from the drugs, keeping them away from the peer pressure, keeping them on the positive track, keeping them involved with church groups, with the Young Life program, and meshing all those together and being one of the ones that kind of brings that all together.
Daric, same question.
Well, that's an easy one. I think that most of our young people these days have the same problem that we had when we were young, all gas pedal and no brake. When it comes to decisions, we really need to teach them how to make those decisions and give them the tools to be able to make good decisions, whether it's alcohol, whether it's marijuana, whether it's driving too fast, regardless of what it is. It's about helping them mature and grow and be able to make those decisions so that when those things come into play, they can say, you know what, that's not for me. I know what the other side of that is, and I'm not willing to do that. I'm making that choice. Young lady that I have with the Explorer program is a perfect example of that. Young Latino lady, Norma Comunas. Many of you may have seen her in the paper today. Norma wanted to make a change in her life and in her community. And she joined the Explorer program. I have another Explorer in the audience tonight. What we try and teach those young people is not about being police officers, it's about being a leader, making a difference. Kathy Strickler at Eagle Valley High School did the exact same thing with the Dads program. She teaches young people how to make decisions and encourages a culture where positive choices make the difference in those young people's lives. DARE programs didn't work. Just Say No programs didn't work. What is working is helping mentor our youth. I'm doing that now, and I want to continue to do that as the sheriff. There's other opportunities. The school resource officers who are in both high schools right now, directing those to have programs to continue to encourage those. There's 4 high schools in our county that don't have SROs. So where is that relationship there? Hopefully it's a parent or a guardian or a teacher or guidance counselor, but I think we can do more together, and I'm going to do that this year. Thank you.
James, you had the first word, so Daric, you will have the last. Closing remarks, please, James.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're going to have a choice here. You're going to have a lot of choices here in the next several weeks. As I've stated, I've been here for 25 years. I've got roots here. I've raised my family here. I have long ties here. The sheriff that's going to represent you needs to have those very same roots and those very same ties to the community, because the sheriff is going to be the one who has to link things together, facilitate, and bring cohesiveness together. I've been doing that for 25 years. Since the time that I've gotten here, I've served on municipal boards, I've served on homeowners boards, I've served abroad, I've served as a liaison, I've served as border talks because of my ability to bring people together and facilitate. Since I've been back, I've served on now 2 different boards. I'm currently the president of Survive, which is a nonprofit restorative justice program, as well as sitting on some of the Relay for Life boards. Ladies and gentlemen, you have some choices, and they're gonna be good choices, but what is it that you truly want? I offer to you transparency. I offer you bringing up the deputies in the sheriff's office up to a higher level. I offer community engagement and bringing the community to the sheriff's office and re-engaging. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm just going to finish with this. I am one of the people here. I am one of us. And I would like your vote, and I look forward to being your next sheriff of Eagle County. Thank you very much.
Daric, final remarks.
I just am humbled by the opportunity to be sitting in front of so many good people, so many of our fellow Eagle County residents here. I asked the lady who was born and raised here, when do you really know that you've become a local? There was some discussion around the PD about that. You become a local when you decide that this is your home. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my home. I have a vested interest in seeing the sheriff's office succeed and reach its complete potential. I'm the person for that job. I've taught management. I've taught supervision to law enforcement officers. I've taught in-service training, firearms, you name it, I've taught it. I've risen through the ranks from an officer up to homicide and then promoted and risen from that up to commander. I've dealt with multi-million-dollar budgets. I've done the things you need as a sheriff. But more than that, look at what I've done here. In the short time that I've been here, I too have been on boards. And some of those boards actually helped create, because I saw a need in Eagle County, not only in Eagle County, but regionally, of things that we needed. Mental health and substance abuse, for an example. We need more crisis beds. Domestic violence. We need better training. Leadership training within the organizations. We need that too. We can be the leader, not only in Eagle County, we could be the leader in the mountain region. We could be the leader in Colorado. But I can't do that without your help. It's for that reason, and the experience that I bring to the organization and the abilities that I have to be able to make the organization better, strike that, not make the organization better. The organization is good and great already. But give the men and women of the sheriff's office the opportunity to shine. That's what a leader truly does, and that's what I'll do as your sheriff. So when November 4th comes, I would ask for your vote and your support. Thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you both.